In the meantime, just come back a little to the reference level descriptions. In a sense, these are a new generation of the series that came around threshold. That is, they're to do with putting the flesh on the bone in regard to specific languages which are adopting the framework concept and adopting the idea of setting objectives by level for learners or for purposes of assessment. The Germans were very quick off the mark to pick this up. I think even before the published version of the framework, with a project called Profile Deutsch, yes, or German Profiles. Could you comment on how that came about from your knowledge and what came out of
it? Yes, well, I had the privilege of being on the committee that oversaw that development in its early stages, not the later ones. And the thing was really that Profiler, that Kontakte, which was the German equivalent of threshold level, drawing both upon the French niveau seuil and the threshold level, was in fact very rich and represented a level of proficiency when, once it was looked at in a six-level scheme, was covered too wide a range.
Is that what you mean by
of
rich?
Levels.
It's sort of,
yes,
contentful.
Yes, indeed. And it contained some useful innovations like the organization of language and language repair. Mm. But so then the first aim was to sort out the material between an A1 and a B2 level, and also to make possible the construction of individualized profiles, and Profile is plural, of course, in German, to construct individual profiles for as learning objectives by combining the elements through a computer program, which might be of themselves arranged at different proficiency levels. Mm. So you might be looking for your reading abilities at a level B1 and your speaking abilities at a level A1.
Mm. So that's a different interpretation of profile.
Yes. And but then later they considered what was possible at the more advanced C levels. Mm. And there they decided that it was not possible to make any specifications of a grammatical or lexical kind, and that they could do so only in terms of, for German, only in terms of rather more demanding can-do statements.
Because it's not only, I think, in the lexicogrammatical area that this project has looked. It's also in the functional domain, the can-dos. We've noted the illustrative scales, which were produced in a certain way and validated in a certain context, which have produced, to be honest, been relatively robust, particularly around the middle of the scale.
Well, yes.
But not at the ends.
No, that is worth saying, because if you're sorting out existing descriptors, then those which are unrealistically high will all be placed at the top end. Mm-hmm. And those which are dismissive and more or less contemptuous will congregate at the lowest level. Mm-hmm. But it isn't possible then to state as an educational objective, for example, that there will be heavy mother tongue interference. Mm.
It's a fact, isn't it?
Yes. And of course, if you put as an objective at the highest level that a person will always be able to speak fluently and accurately without hesitation on any subject, including the intellectually most demanding, at any time and under any conditions, then these will be, you can put these down on paper, but nobody will ever satisfy them.
No.
And they will not be of any assistance to people working practically in trying to organize educational effort at an advanced level.
So, and so that raises an interesting question about the nature of a C2 level. We always thought here, working in Cambridge, that the certificate of proficiency was a pretty good operationalization of that level. You alluded to it before. But if you look at the descriptors, and they are few and far between, you might be disinclined to endorse that view. Where do you think the truth lies? You talk about educational realities. Surely, if it's going to be useful, the C2 level must be something which can be achieved within an educational context. Otherwise, it's a kind of aim which is beyond the relevance of most people.
Yeah, yes. Well, one of the reasons for starting with A and going up to C was that it was open-ended at the top level. C2 is conceived as being the highest level at which it is feasible to organize socially language learning for viable numbers in a realistic adult educational context.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, of course, not perfection.
No.
But if for some particular highly specialized professional purposes, people want to bring quite small groups of people to a higher level of proficiency, usually in some restricted respects.
Professionally or academically.
And to provide a corresponding qualification, which will be taken only by very small groups, then there's nothing to stop people adding a D level if they can adequately describe it.
Mm-hmm. Well, so people are indeed talking about it, and that the delimitation of the C level and the C1, C2, I think is something which is coming out perhaps of the these reference level description projects.
Well, it is very interesting in the work of John Hawkins and his group,
mm-hmm.
that the command over new structures, many of which are sentence embedding structures,
mm-hmm.
Are most numerous at the C levels.
Mm-hmm.
That is what the ability to do these things fluently and to incorporate them appropriately in language usage is something which does tend to come out at C level. But those are the levels at which the German group decided that they were not feasible.
Mm.
So there is an interesting area of development there.
So this is actually quite new research you're referring to.
Yes.
The Profile Deutsch predated the framework but has continued. And in fact, in two phases, it had the publication of the first A to B2 and then C levels. In 2004, or thereabouts, I think it was, the Council of Europe initiated a call for more proposals for reference level descriptions and set out some guidelines and called some meetings in Strasbourg. I attended one of them. And I know that about 17 proposals were on the table for different languages to develop RLDs, as they became known, for their own language. And at that time, the proposal for an English version was made, which subsequently has become known as the English Profile Programme. Programme being a long-term intellectual endeavour with practical outcomes envisaged to add the English flesh to the CEFR bone, a sort of CEFR for English concept. And one element of the work, as you know, has been to look at the lexicogrammatical progression from both a linguistic and a psycholinguistic perspective, with reference to, hence my point earlier, to relevant second language acquisition research, as well as linguistic and pedagogic concepts. What do you think about the way that program has been developing?
Well, I think it's very promising in a number of different ways. And for example, I very much like the approach to vocabulary development, which recognizes that because you know meet and know a particular word in one context, it doesn't mean to say that that word can then be ticked off a list as known.
Yes.
Because it's a linguistic commonplace that that the higher the frequency of a word, the greater is the likelihood of its being polysemic.
Mm-hmm. Having and various meanings.
Having a variety of meanings and a wide range of usage. Mm-hmm. And so that learning, once it is first encountered and first learned as a formal unit, then consists in being able to use it in a variety of different contexts with a variety of different meanings and an increasingly wide range of usage. And that development needs to be incorporated into a program of vocabulary development.
Oh.
And that will not be satisfied by identifying one particular meaning or use and then regarding the word as being then available for the rest of the range. Mm-hmm. I think that is one thing. Also, I think the work on the emergence and mastery of different grammatical structures at different levels is a considerable promise,
mm-hmm.
Though it's still a long way from being able to give an overall picture, coherent and comprehensive, for grammatical development in English.
Sure. And in fact, I think the team working on it, the so-called English Profile Research Team here in Cambridge, has set itself a slightly narrower objective.
Yes.
What they've been trying to do, I think, is to identify some key features in the linguistic progression.
Yes.
Which they term as criterial. Now, this is needs to be unpacked a little, this term, but basically it means features which coalesce together and tend to represent what is likely to be the language of a person who has achieved a certain stage of development in their interlanguage of English.
Yes.
And perhaps influenced by, almost certainly influenced by, key factors such as their first language or the context under which they have been learning the language.
Yeah.
So it's beginning to add a bit of calibration into the parameters of linguistic description.
Of course, it brings dangers, and one has to be careful not to abuse it,
mm-hmm.
as one has to be careful to not to over-interpret and abuse other aspects of the framework. If, for example, if you were to publish that the grade that you were given, or your success or failure in one of the Cambridge suite of examinations, was going to develop, was going to depend upon your knowledge of half a dozen criterial features for a particular level, then one knows very well that in some schools preparing candidates, they would spend 6 months practicing those six features to the not worrying about the rest of the language. And I have actually, in one or two cases, met schools which have concentrated upon the superficial and even irrelevant features of a test rather than making the general language preparation which will enable people to
That's the biggest danger of publishing word lists as well. I mean, as you know, in some parts of the world they love word lists as part of the resource for teaching.
Yeah.
And I think the people who've worked on the English profile vocabulary profile, in a sense the word list, have taken that on board.
Yeah.
But it, again, like all aspects of the framework and its tools, you have to put the caveats in place, you have to give the guidance for appropriate use, and expect potentially that misuse might occur, but...
Well, of course, in the framework itself, one didn't go into the kind of detail that would result in vocabulary lists. Mm. In the threshold level series, we increasingly moved away from specifying particular lexical items in favour of areas of lexical development.
Sure. Which is in a sense what's going on in the English profile.
Yeah.
And looking at how lexical capacity develops and expands as well as simply goes up in a kind of staircase model.
Yes.
And that applies to the linguistic features as well. I mean, not the grammatical ones in association with the words, which are often triggers for particular more complex structures. But the difference, perhaps, compared with the time that you and Jan van Eck were putting together the taxonomies for threshold, is that the contemporary approach is not only to use knowledge and intuition from the pedagogic context and of course experience, but also to compare that with data which can be collected from learners in terms of what language they actually produce. So if you have someone who's, shall we say, at the threshold level or is seen to be more or less at that level, they produce language in context in which they are operating, whether it's in the classroom or in an exam, which represents an externalized form of their underlying knowledge in some way, so writing or speaking, which can contribute to the analysis.
Yes, well, I think it's very likely that since, you know, after all, what we were doing with the threshold level originally is now, what, getting on for 40 years ago.
Mm.
And there have to be, I trust, a significant development since that time. In those days, we certainly felt that data corpora, lexical corpora, were inadequate, and that what is called intuition is the result of an unconscious statistical treatment of experience, which is very much richer than any existing corpus. And that the corpora reflected in the, when it came outside the top couple of hundred words that are very largely part of the grammatical apparatus, when it came to the free lexical items, they were far there was no statistical stability, and it was far too much dependent upon the nature of the texts which were chosen. Either spoken or written. And of course, big differences between spoken and written corpora. Yes, for example, which is by far the most frequent word in spoken corpora, is almost non-existent in written corpora. So we did not follow lexico-statistical selection, but preferred to identify areas of word fields, I suppose,
right,
which seem to be relevant to the objectives that we were looking at, and then to use our own experience, which I think tends to be confirmed by later data studies, on what are frequent, basic, and less so. I mean, with pets, what comes to mind are cats and dogs, rather than hamsters and guinea pigs. Mm. And so on with other things. If you're working at a very basic level, as we were with threshold level, there isn't likely to be a gross discrepancy anyway. But, you know, we were struck by the fact that in the great Puerto Rican study, the most frequent month of the year was May, because one of the texts chosen was the countryside in spring, of essays by school children on that topic. And one tends to find that all the days of the week are present in the first 3,000 words, except Tuesday, because nothing ever happens on a Tuesday.
So I mean, what you've just highlighted is the problem, in a sense, of using corpora, which is that the analysis you do depends on what you collect in the first place.
Yes.
And if that's a narrow sample, you get a narrow analysis. Mm. But I think most corpus linguists
this was 40 years ago. What I think one needs to look at very carefully is statistical stability.
Mm. And of course, that does need a lot of data.
And you have an enormous, in any corpus, there is the largest, I think even now, the largest statistical samples are nonce occurrences.
Mm. Well, I mean, I think this is flagging up something which is known within the reference level description project, that in order to have an accurate analysis of what learners' language is like, you have a big job to collect enough evidence from enough types of learners, different types of learners, to formulate a very complete and categorical
analysis.
I think
the search for statistical stability in lexical corpora is a worthy one, and I wish it every good luck. But I'm not very happy if people claim to have reached it when they haven't.